How you doing, everybody? This is Doug Wilson, and you're watching Yellow Hawk Customs Outdoors. I'm glad you could join us today. We got Bob here again. I mean, this guy, I can always count on him to rev things up, you know, to really punch through the envelope.
Yeah, I'm like a plague.
So you guys stay tuned. We got some backpacks, a wool anorak, some other stuff to talk about. We'll be right back. Okay, guys and gals, so we're back from that badass introduction.
Yeah.
And I want to introduce Bob the Grizz with his stuff. He's got stuff.
All right. Hey, how you guys doing? And gals, too. Yeah, I shaved my mustache off. It was part of...
What's different about
you.
Yeah,
it was part of a deal I had about winning our C-Conference Lacrosse Championship, so I shaved my mustache off.
You actually look different.
Yeah, I know, man. Well, hopefully I look 10 years younger and more handsome. Anyway.
I always thought you were handsome.
Well, thank you, brother. I appreciate it. We got to stop kissing like this. I mean, meeting like this. Anyway, hey, this is a number of different things I just want to talk about, I put together, that I think about during the week and, you know, come up here and share on Doug's channel. First of all, I just want to let you guys know that Doug has been my friend for the longest time, okay? I couldn't get rid of him when he was a teenager.
Oh my God.
He was like a damn leech, okay?
I was.
And every time, if I needed a backpacking buddy or if I needed to go on an adventure or something, he was there. Whether he was sick, whether, you know, it was cold, whatever.
Bob was the most interesting person I had ever met in my life.
Yeah.
And he was like a magnet.
Yeah, I'm getting dull now. Because I'm getting old. But anyway, I try. I have my moments. But anyway, I just want to let you know that this, and I wrote this on the Facebook channel, that, you know, the channel that Doug has and we all promote, the click and whatever, and Doug himself, he's a good guy, all right? You're not going to get a better friend, and you're not going to get a better person. I mean, he really believes in what he sells and what he does. His attention to detail and everything he does is evident, okay? And sometimes, you know, we need a little push from behind to make us feel good, and I want to do that for him today, because every once in a while, you know, you know you're doing a good product, you know you're putting something out, but it's always good to have a slap on the back and, hey buddy, you're doing great, especially from somebody I think he respects and admires. But anyway, I just want to say that to him. He's my friend, he's my good friend, and you know, I don't know if this is an honor or not, but when I die, I'm being cremated. I'm asking him to hike up on the Appalachian Trail and spread my ashes all over the trail.
Which I will surely do.
And I know he will do that, okay? So it's rare that you have one good friend, let alone five good friends. So I'd rather have one than five. So I just want to get that out there, okay? Great guy, good product, stands by his word, he's honest, and he has a no bullshit attitude like myself, okay? Although he's a little more politically correct than me, but as you get older, you don't really give a shit, okay? Okay, let's get to what I want to talk about today.
Thank you, Bob.
You're welcome, brother. Anyway, as you know, there's thousands of name droppers out there about different products, okay? Now, you only know what you know by what you're exposed to, all right?
Right.
So if everybody is using in your area Bocco saw for sawing, evidently, everyone's got to get one to identify with the bushcrafting society or group. Well, you're not a bushcrafter, okay? All right. It doesn't matter whether your skill sucks. But as long as you got that Bocco saw on your side, boy, you must be the shiznit, all right? Well, personally, I like the Silky Boy, all right? I've looked at videos of the Silky Boy, and my friend Lars in Russia, who I really dig, okay? He swears by the Silky Boy in all different lengths. Now, you can have your opinions about either one. I'm just saying that products come about by people bragging about them and saying they do a good job, sometimes without comparing another product.
I guess I need to get a Silky Boy.
Which is cheaper, okay, because I got a Coghlan saw that back in the 70s and 80s worked.
That was the shiznit.
It worked, okay? So I don't push, it's not so much I push names as much as I put a item or a product. So
or an idea.
An idea. That being said, here's a Puka made by Kellum, okay? And this is the one that Doug...
I wear it all the time.
Wear most of the time. Right?
It's a great woodworker.
You know, real nice knife, okay? Good woodworker, you know, Scandi grind, you know, all the good stuff, you know, whatever. It's rustic looking. And you know
it's
me...
It's got that traditional look.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know?
And I think it belongs in a sheath like this.
And I keep it in the original sheath.
You know, because that's your traditions. And traditions, they go lifetimes. And,
right.
and they still work, okay? So that's where I'm at when it comes to gear. But anyway, I got another one. I have a longer one than this, and I have a wider one called the Wolverine, okay? Which they're all part of my collection. But great knives, great sheaths, and I picked up for a really, really good price. That's me. I'm a cheapskate.
Like 50, 60 bucks, aren't they?
They go like $64 to $68 on
yeah,
eBay.
They're not expensive.
I got this for like 50 bucks. No, with free shipping and handling
right.
and everything.
But okay? Make no mistake, guys, that is not a fixed blade knife.
It's a rat tang.
It's a rat tang, and you will break it under hard use.
You can. And it's a sharp, thin knife, and that's what it's used for.
Right. Slicing.
Fish prep, you know, some small game prep. You know, cutting rope, you know, whatever. It's not a hard beat up the shell. Now, if you had to, you would use this knife. If it's all you got.
If you had to.
Okay. But they're pretty durable, and the possibility of them... I don't know. I've never broke one.
I've taken this knife and I've batoned with it, right? Bigger than I should have. And it has done the work. But it's still not a fixed blade knife. You got to keep that in mind.
Yeah.
I mean, it is, but it's a rat tail.
Right.
You know what I mean?
You got to use your knife for what it's made for. Bottom line.
Right. Intended purposes.
Right. So that's that. Okay. Now, as I was searching eBay, I'm an eBay hound, I came upon this knife here, which looks like an N-Trek.
Woohoo!
Okay, it's not. Doug was telling me it's not. There's no markings on it. It's a Puka style, which I like. It's got some nice scalloping down here for the thumb. It's got a nice wide, you know, palm swell in the middle, and it's like a cherry wood. Okay, and the guy said there's a crack on the back here. I don't really give a shit. There's a little crack back here on the handle.
Yeah.
See that?
Yeah,
you know, and it's not going to do anything. It's fixed. It's a full tang knife.
Hardwood.
You know, it's really a great little knife. And he put it in a, what kind of sheath is this?
I want to say JRE, but JRE usually, these are the same sheaths that LT Wright uses. So whoever he uses, I forget.
Yeah.
So many facts and figures out there, I just forget.
Right. I'm not a spec guy. I'm pretty much aesthetics, and I've always been successful with aesthetics. If it looks good, it's got to be good.
I think the ones he uses.
So anyway. That being said, it's a sharp knife. I've sharpened it up. I think it's a kind of a flat grind. It's a nice little everyday carry. And for you guys that are on a budget, there you go. Hey, you don't have to have name brand stuff, okay? As long as it cuts, sharpens, and works.
Let's say something real quick.
All right.
I want to interject this because I think of things on spur of the moment, and I have to say them because I'll forget to say them later, right? This kind of knife right here is very difficult to Kydex. Here's the reason. There's no retention point on this knife anywhere, not even on the handle. You might be able to get a button retention right here, but you probably couldn't count on it because it's such a small hole. So I would have to do a compression fit for this, where the Kydex actually grabs the blade when you put it in. Okay? So you can see there's no place for the click. Right? No place for the Kydex to grab onto.
Yeah, form around.
Right, to form around to give you that click. So, just to say that real quick.
And that's good.
I'm always thinking of Kydex.
Yeah, he has Kydex underwear. Anyway.
I do. Have you seen it?
No, I haven't seen it.
It's pink.
Is it pink?
It's pink.
Excellent.
Yeah.
All right, now.
Real men can wear pink.
Another real simple thing I want to show you guys. These are actually ski poles. Okay.
Ooh.
I got them in New Jersey on the Appalachian Trail in a little town I can't remember the hell
they're
it was.
They're cross-country ski poles.
They're cross. I cut off the baskets because right. I ran over them with my Jeep. But anyway, I cut them off. And downhill, and they're aluminum. They're made out of aluminum. And they're German, okay? And you got some dings on them, whatever. I paid $3 for these, okay? They had a strap on them for handing or whatever, but I took the strap off, okay? You don't have to go getting all these high-speed, collapsible, hydraulic, spring-loaded things, okay?
The trekking poles that I have.
The trekking poles that other people have. I mean, you know, what did they use before they had that shit? Wood! Sticks. They use sticks, okay? So I've got another pair of these that are actually cross-country ski poles. I paid $4 for, okay? They work great. And I don't like shit that has articulations or collapsings and locks and all.
They
you know why?
They are failure points.
Because they fail.
Yeah, they
That's
are failure
That's why
points.
I don't like them. All right,
but
so.
I'm such a gearhead, so.
I know. Well, anyway, to each his own. But I just thought I'd show you this for just a price, you know, mark or something that'll work. And then if you lose them or they bust up, you don't cry, okay? Because you paid $150 for the Alpine Swiss trekking poles that come from Switzerland. So, coming back to the wandering parson, okay, Toby Holland. I like this guy. Okay, he's a straight up, honest kind of guy, creative, willing to take suggestions,
right,
and run with them. Because after all, we want him to have a better product for us. Science right. is kind of selfish because. Right. If he's putting out a really better, we're not going to go anyplace else
right.
to look around for getting a,
if you're
say,
already
an anorak.
Getting the best, there's no reason to go anywhere else.
Right. So we already, and he's within a price point which is affordable for all of
yeah,
us.
He's affordable.
Okay. And he's in Johnstown, Pennsylvania, I think it is, Johnstown. Anyway, he's in PA and near State College. But he's a good guy. I've talked to him, PM'd him, whatever. And he's willing to look at different designs and things of that nature. So if you ever deal with him, kick him an idea, all right? And he'll work with you. And that's right. what we want on this channel, is guys
and
that work.
Make no mistake, we support other makers. You know, the Hidden Woodsman, Malcolm Coderre, he's a bomb up there, right? I just have not had the opportunity to have him on the channel and push his gear because I don't have a lot of it. You know what I mean? So
yeah,
we do push other... You know, this isn't like the end all and
right.
be all and end all of gear, right? So.
But for me, I have a kind of a personal relationship with him, and I like him. Okay, if I like you, I like you. If I don't like you, you're shit out of luck.
You're done.
Okay, that's all I gotta say. Anyway, I purchased a wool anorak from him a couple weeks ago with a hood. So forth, hood, and he's got some nice, paracord, draw strings with nice stoppers here, clicking. And me, you know, I like the zipper. This already came with a zipper. This was already pre-made. And he said, "Hey Bob, you know, what do you think?" And I said, "Hey, I like it. Okay, the sleeves are long. Like I like the sleeves long to go over my hands in case I'm cold. All right." It's a nice ragged wool. I like that kind of rustic stuff, you know, medieval things, because like I told you, I'm from another century. Had a fly bite me down here. Anyway, I knew I was sweet, but I didn't know I was that sweet. Nice big ample cargo pocket, which I like, okay? He's got a, this goes down to or below my knees, which I think is great. You can always, bring these up like so up around your waist, and you can toggle them tight around your waist if you want them to get out of the way for, you know, sitting down or whatever. But it for some people this might be a little scratchy for them. I found this scratchy, but I'm hairy, and over a period of time this will all flatten out a little bit and you won't feel it at all. All in all, great product, great anorak. I want to thank Toby again for reaching out and helping us out with this kind of stuff, okay? All right, that's that. Now, one of the things in continuing this video, we're gonna talk about rucks and sort of like a general overview of the evolution of rucksacks, European and going into American and military, okay? So anyway, this is another ruck that Toby has put out on the market. okay? Good buckles, nice straps, okay? Paracord again. It's got a regular flap, which is traditionally just a ruck. They just had a flap, you know. Later on, they started putting pockets in the top, but a general ruck, just a flap, all right? It's basically, a ruck is basically a big sack that tightens around the top,
okay? This is a day ruck.
This is like a day ruck, okay? And it'll hold anywhere, I guess, around 15 to 20 pounds or so, maybe a 20 liter, if that's what you want to call it, type of ruck. On the inside, he's got a carrier pouch here that you can lock your Coleman or your, what do you call it, there's a Camelback reservoir onto, right, right. And put it back here. Give you a little bit more protection on your back, which he already has a closed cell type of foam in the back here for your back.
Yeah, a lot of guys do that. Yep.
And he has three, it chinches up, so here we're gonna push him a little bit here.
It chinches up, but it's not chinchy.
It's not chinchy. There you go, the Wandering Parson, okay. And he also has one here. There's three outside pouches, which I like. Okay, see?
Wandering Parson.
Yeah, you can get, you probably get half liter bottles in there. You might be able to get a tin of some sort, you know. You can put your knit hat, your wool glove.
I think a liter bottle would fit in there.
No. I tried a 750, it's a little too long. And one of the things that stops that, and this is just an observation, he's got nice zippers, is that this waterproofing that goes over your zipper normally, okay, I think is a little too long. I would recommend that he bring his the zippers up a little higher and then put a flap over them, because it'd be easier to get the bottles in and out.
And we understand why he does this, but we just think that the zipper
would just be more effective, more convenient to be getting a water bottle in and out, okay? That's all. But this is very secure the way he has it here, so it would keep things dry if you need to get things dry, okay? Water bottles don't need to be dry. All right. Anyway, he has a hanging loop here. And he also has a yoke suspension. Now, the failure parts on most rucks, and when I get into the military rucks, I will tell you where it is here. It's right here, because they rely on this area to carry all the weight between the shoulder blades,
right.
Okay? And all the weight is a drag. Rucks actually drag. They come down sideways, rather than a regular backpack. It tries to stay straight up and down, okay? Or compressed to your body. So he's got a really nice supporting band through here. I'm sure it's bar tacked or double stitch. I don't know, but the yoke here, you're seeing on some of the kids' backpacks, is the way to go. Rather than taking two single
things
and sewing them
in
here.
Sits on the back of your neck, real nice and comfortable. The other place that these things will fail
is here.
And I'll tell you, I have had a lot of experience with shoulder straps pulling out of backpacks, is right here.
Right.
You go to, when people put a backpack on, they tend to use the shoulder straps instead of the haul loop like they're supposed to use in order to put it on.
Right.
So.
Well, the thing is that, again, like knives, you have to use this for what it's intended for.
Right.
Okay. He's got a little sternum strap here, which I think is very nice. It doesn't really need it, but I think it's a very nice gesture. He's got some gear loops here that you can tie some things onto if you want, you know, flashlight or pouch hanging or whatever the case might be.
Or a Kydex knife sheath.
He's got a nice, this is waterproof down here. It's a little thick Kodora type bottom. Most rucks had a rubberized bottom on them of some sort, and then the rest was canvas or a really thick nylon. Okay, but all in all, it's well made. The price point is good. He will give it you in colors. This is brown and black. He'll try to work with you with colors, whatever. I think that if you're going to really, ruck the hell out of this, you need a thicker mill nylon.
Yeah.
And it just needs some bar tacking throughout the pack in certain areas.
I don't think this is going to take really heavy use.
No, not heavy gear.
It's a day ruck.
So if you have a son or daughter, young person, even yourself, you just want to go on a day hike, take some water, take some M&Ms, trail mix, whatever, some clothing. Like I said, if you start pushing this beyond 15 pounds, especially with water weight, it's gonna hurt the pack over a period of time. This could be a great diaper bag for moms. They could put the bottles in these outside things. A gym bag.
That's great, Bob. It's just what these guys want to hear.
Well, you never know. They might want to be a mom. Anyway, a good gym bag, a everyday carry type of bag that you go to work with.
Yeah, EDC bag.
You know, whatever. So all in all, it's generally a very nice ruck. Okay, so kudos to Toby. And
yeah, he did a great job.
He did a nice job. And he, you know, only other thing I would suggest, and I did pee him in on this, is to make this wider at the bottom like traditional rucks are. They're usually narrow at the top and then they widen out like so. All right. But then because that wideness is supposed to wrap around your hips if you had a hip belt, like something you're carrying somebody on your back with their legs around you. Okay. But all in all, nice product.
So Toby's engaged in an evolution right now. He's putting out better and better and better products.
Yes.
We'll see what he does in a couple of years.
He has some different packs on there. I don't know if this is the Allegheny. There's another one he has out there. And I've also talked to him about making a good size, I don't know, 4,000 cubic inch actual ruck on a frame. When I see him in the fall, we go to the December rendezvous, I have the Vietnam type frames. Okay. He's coming. Yeah. And he won't be able to make it on Sunday because he's a parson. He's a reverend.
He's making backpacks.
He's a Lutheran. He's minister.
Right. He's a Lutheran minister.
Okay. So he's giving his time.
See, that shows to his credit.
Yeah. Right. So he's giving his time to God. But anyway, I have a frame that's the old Vietnam type of frame that I'd like to see he could work with to put a bigger ruck onto it. So that's down the road. Okay? So next in this evolution, we're going to talk about some military style packs in quite a minute. Okay? Catch you in a little bit. So now, coming back to rucks, when I was a boy, I lived in Sunny Surplus. And you guys ain't from Maryland, maybe you had another surplus, Clara's Surplus, I don't know, but this was Sunny's. They're not in business anymore. But I could relive World War II, Korea, not Vietnam yet at the time because the surplus wasn't running there yet, but you could buy a 30-06 for like $15 and have it sporterized. The smell of canvas for me was like, was like a whore's cologne, man. I loved it.
I hung out at the outpost at Fort Bragg.
Oh, yeah. I love surplus stores, man. Place. I just love surplus stores. But anyway, I'm a big guy for if you don't have a lot of money, there's some really good military gear out there. And I'm going to talk about one of them right now. Oh, and if you want to see some cool rucks, go watch where Eagles Dare with Clint Eastwood and Richard Burton.
I think I read that
they
book.
Got some really neat white camo canvas rucks.
Ice Station Zebra?
No, any ice station. It's where Eagles Dare. They invade this place. It's German guns and whatever, and snow, whatever. It's really quite cool.
Is it a movie?
It's a movie where Eagles Dare.
Yeah.
So anyway, I've always pictured I'm a romanticist, a traditionalist. You know, you see the Swiss and Austrian climbers with that ruck on their back, and it's dragging down, and it's got this little frame here, or just. Has a leather patch here and that's where the straps come off,
Like that wilderness experience Stephen used to have.
Yeah. And that was mine. That was the caribou. Oh, that was mine.
The one with the leather bottom.
Yeah.
That caribou.
Was the caribou.
Right.
So anyway, I just dug it, I just thought that was like that's like what soldiers are supposed to carry, man. You know what I mean? That's just cool. All right.
Not
so anyway,
no more.
Coming into Vietnam, you had a frame that was basically shaped like a mustache on the bottom wrapped around. I have one I didn't bring with me. And a loop here. Like I said before about rucks, the main drag was here. This is where it put all your weight on the middle of your back. So in the center of your back, that's where the weight went.
Even with the hip belt attached.
Well,
the actual
rucks didn't have hip belt attached. They had a straight strap that just sat above your hips.
Right, lumbar pad.
And that's it. It wasn't even a lumbar pad. It was like a belt like this wide made out of nylon or leather. And if you go and look on eBay, they have some of the old Austrian, they have like felt underneath the leather straps. They're always skinny, so they put felt under them to try to make it nicer.
More comfortable.
But it would rip into your shoulders.
Anyway.
And it just the dynamics and the physiology of the pack to the body was 2 points here in the small of the back and here at the lower lumbar region. Okay, well, the Army in its infinite wisdom came out with the Alice pack, which is kind of late Vietnam era. I rucked them in the 80s, okay, early when I was with the Marines as a Navy corpsman. I rucked them, but I always loved them. I have like 4 of them, maybe 5. Okay, one's a Korean model.
They're
that's
all
actually
strewn
new.
Around his bed.
Yeah,
he names them.
I sleep them.
Puts
yeah.
little hats on them.
But anyway, so I think, you know, this is like a 70-pound ruck. 70 pounds will go in this ruck. Okay, now unlike the medium, you have to have a frame with this pack. This is the large. The medium, you can have a
right,
frame
you can
or
use
straps.
That as a frameless ruck.
Okay. But I'm going to talk about the Marine Corps' newer ruck, the IBLE or whatever it is.
IOBE.
Whatever it is. I'm going to talk about that you actually can without a frame attach these to it. I bought one cheap just to see what it looked like, and I'm going to show it to you next. But anyway,
you can attach these to it or the frame.
You can attach these to them and wear it without a frame.
Ah.
You don't need a frame. Okay. So anyway, this is one I gave Doug. What's nice
yeah, this one's mine. This one's mine.
The nice is a nice little pouch thing here. You can load this up, and as you can see, this was kind of waterproofing has run off, but that happens to a lot of them. Okay, on the outside, as we've already told you before, we like pouches on the outside because you can get to your gear in other videos. Okay,
this is my bug out bag.
As you can see, you can get snaps, pouch, 3 pouches here for magazines, whatever you need to get to real fast. Okay, you're like he said, you never know when you're gonna lose your toothbrush. You need your toothbrush, bar of soap, you know, whatever, just that stuff that you don't want to dig deep down inside your bag for. It you're going to use all the time.
Yeah, poncho, whatever,
you know, whatever. So then here on this one, unlike the medium has 3 bags like this size. Okay, but the large has a big one in the middle where you can put an MRE. Okay, yeah, and you can put skis through there, whatever. Yeah. Because you can line poles, you can line it through here. Okay, but anyway, you can put your big number of MREs in here, or your stove, or your camp utensils and pot and everything, you know, right there. And you just go boom out here. You don't have to dig inside. Out here, you can put like, you know, a cap and gloves, extra underwear, you know, whatever. And then they have these ties here, which we used to put these on them.
Right.
What do you call them? The clip-on thing.
Toggle.
The toggle thing. Okay. We used to trade them out. Anyway, because then you could cinch them up and whatever. Okay.
Cord lock.
So there's 3 out there. On the bottom, if you have the frame, you can actually attach. You know, this is missing its straps. No, it isn't.
No.
No, it's not. They're here.
Yeah.
They're here.
They're on the top.
Yeah, you can get more gear in if you want right here. You can put it through here and cover over, or you can put it lower down on your back. Okay, so also you can put some belt loops through here and round them this way if you want to carry your sleeping pad or whatever. Okay, one of the things I like about this these frames is you can use them to haul cargo if you have a shelf. Now I have some packs with the shelf. They're not as big as you think they are. They're only about from here, they're only about that wide. Okay,
yeah,
that you could rest. Really, they were to rest the old radios. What were they called? The prick.
PRC 74.
74 or something like that. Yeah. Rest them on there, whatever. Also, inside here, it goes straight down. Okay, straight on down. It's voluminous. And you also, this was a radio pouch too. The radios would sit in here sometimes, the antenna out the top, whatever. But I mean, this would be great for a camelback reservoir, whatever. Okay, but as you can see, this thing flares out. Like that, it goes in narrow,
yeah,
flares
wide.
Out.
You can get a sleeping bag in here real easy.
Right, and then there's ties in the bottom if you want to secure that bag down to the bottom. Okay, but the thing I like about this frame again is that when you're wearing it out like so, Doug, if you hold this out like so,
sure.
Okay, you can actually put gear in between here. Something that's soft, you can roll up your anorak and shove it in here. It'll
or
sit
a poncho.
Poncho will sit right in here. Something that
poncho liner.
Gets cold, you stop. You want to throw something on. I like that because there's another area that you can actually soften up your back and have gear there at the same time. Okay. The other reason I like this is because, like I said, you can put the straps here. Now let's say you want to haul wood, like in December we may need to haul wood. So you know, you put your straps through here and maybe have a shelf or you don't. Load your wood down like so, bring them down up here, over across the wood, over here, and you can lock them down. You can ruck them up to wherever you need to go, and then put your pack back on. The main area of this pack that you want to watch for is right here. This is a nylon type of grid pattern, I don't know, material. But this is what makes the whole frame. It sits on the frame. Okay, it's nice and thick. It also gives you a little bit of padding for your back. They're not the most comfortable to ruck in. I know I've rucked them.
They're not bad either.
They're just
not real comfortable.
So one of the things
you can modify them.
Right. You can get different hip belts. You can get newer ones, whatever you want to do with it. Okay. The straps here, these are the quick release in case you had to dump the pack if you're under enemy fire and you want to get rid of it. We've never had these come apart. We were just talking about that. But just for shits and giggles, I would take electrical tape and tape them down, because I'm not going to dump it. Okay. I mean, hopefully not. And
even then, it's enough electrical tape that if you have to dump it, you can rip through
your ribbon, right. And then we were talking about what we call the pipe insulation. There's this black, thick foam pipe insulation.
Right.
We used to take that, undo this, slide this on, so it covered, you know, quickly. It would pat it up, and we would take duct tape and tighten it up.
Right.
And after many months or so of using this, it forms to your shoulders. It really quite gets nicely.
It's more comfortable.
So all in all, you know, if you want a good, dependable pack, you can get these for anywhere with the pack by itself without the frame for 20 some odd bucks. The frame's gonna cost you maybe $30 to $50, whatever, depending upon the condition it's in, okay? But if you want a pack that carries everything, this is the one for you. I got this fly that likes me. I don't know. Anyway, so that being said, I'm gonna bring up another pack here in just a minute, okay? So now I want to talk about this. I think it's called the LILBE. It's Marine Corps, although I was in the Army, so I put my U.S. Army thing on here. This pack is made a little heavier than the Alice Ruck. It's a little thicker. It's got a little more, it's like a Cordura type. It's not as nylon-ish, okay? It's got tons of the Molly attachments on here that you can use, all right? And one thing I like about it is it's got these long tubes area here. You can put your pack through here. You could put, I mean, not your pack, your tent through here. You can put a sitting stool like I carry, or you can put, you know, poles through here, ski poles, whatever. And they will come in and sit inside this really nice elastic type canteen holder on the bottom. You don't have to use it for water bottles. You can use it for anything else you would like in conjunction with the loop. It's on both sides, all right? Another thing that's kind of neat about this pack is you can unzip it and you can get to your gear like this, just going right inside the bag, okay? Which is, you know, I don't really care about that, but if you want to get something fast, you need a grenade or something, you know, you might want to have that handy, all right? As a traditional ruck, it has a flap here. It has a flap zipper and opening here that you can put some stuff up inside here, and it has a mesh backing, okay? Now, on this particular one, you get these in different conditions, so you're just going to have to deal with what you get. You can see some abrasion here and whatever, which isn't going to hurt too much. This for me, this ruck is something I just take for a camping weekend or a camping week where I'm not carrying it. I'm not going to carry it, okay? So anyway, it has another big opening. Now it has a chinch up area, but you see it was busted up. So I taped it, and what I don't really need it, I just turn it on the inside like this and use this drawstring to bring things together, okay? Now on the inside...
That's just an extender though, right?
Yeah, it's extender. Right. Now on the inside of this, it also has the radio pouch. You can put, you know, your camel back in here or whatever other little things, as we say, sundries in here. And in the bottom...
the toothbrush.
In the bottom there's a zippered partition if you want to separate the two from the sleeping bag area, which is here, you see? And which is kind of nice too, because they have a strap here. You can strap your bag down or whatever. And if I want to, I can unzipper this and make it one through bag, you see. I like bags that are wide at the bottom, like I like my women. I like bags that come like this. the modern backpack is really built well. It keeps, you know, your weight straight up and down and close to your body, and there's usually no drag, okay? With these, even with the frame, there can be a little bit of a drag back, That's why I would put a frame, a ledge on here. Okay, see, I have the ability to put a ledge on here. But like I said on the other, prior to this one, it's not that wide that it'll actually not, you won't get any drag. But it's mostly on the frame itself, not on you. It's transferred to the frame and not onto your body. Let's see. What else can I talk about here? Oh, they got an inside zipper here to carry, you know, your toothpaste, toothbrush, whatever. Okay, it's up to you. Now, what happened here with this, let's grab my sunglasses. What happened with here is that this, the actual buckles for this, like I said, you have to buyer beware. See, it's ripped out on this one side, okay? Yeah. So I couldn't use it. So you have to be creative. Like I said, being creative, I took the side strap buckles that are here, and I bring them around the side, and they have a side clip here, and it keeps the flap down. So no muss, you know, no problem. It'll still work, see? Okay? Nice and big, made well. Of course, this is not made for an Alice frame. The frame that they have for it's like a, it's like those Molly frames the Army has, made out of like a plastic, a dynamic plastic or whatever.
Yeah.
And these packs,
I don't know why they went to them.
They break. Okay.
They break. I broke one.
And in the frigid cold, they'll break.
Yeah.
This pack is made by Proper. Although they were actually given to Arc'teryx, I think you were saying initially.
It might be the internal frame pack that, yeah, Arc'teryx designed or whatever.
But let me tell you guys and gals, there's a lot of them out there. I mean, and they're in decent shape. You just got to buy them.
Yeah.
It's got hull loops here. It's got hull. I mean, if I didn't have the frame, I could just use it as a duffel bag, you know. But here's the secret. It's kind of interesting. If you go on eBay, you'll see guys putting this on the Alice frame, and it does have a sleeve here, although not as thick as the one on the Alice rug and padded. It is here and it will fit. Okay, the other thing with this is that these clips and these rings down here, see, I have these rings tied here to give it more compression to the frame. If you were to take this Alice piece here, which actually just goes through itself through the ring here in the hole here, see that? Okay, and you put it through that ring and you bring it up here,
looks like an Alice
and
frame.
you take it off the frame, and you get a male clip for this side. You could take it and clip it and not use the frame. So you could have a frameless pack
if you wanted to.
You have a rucksack.
Right.
And the thing about rucksacks is that they take on the form of what you fill them with.
Right.
And that's why there's a certain way of filling your pack so that you find most of your weight is between mid back, okay, to almost the tailbone, and then everything else is above or below. But
yeah,
most of your weight you want to carry across your scapulas, okay, or your shoulder blades. That's where you want your weight, not up high on the shoulders like a high framed old backpacking frame packs used to. You know, you're bent over like this, and you had to use a taut line. And if you don't know what that is, we'll do that in another video, okay? But like Doug and I have said before, is that most of your weight should be carried on your hips because there's the bigger muscles there. You have the buttocks there. You know, if you suffer from no ass at all, then you have a problem.
And that's how modern backpacks are made.
Right.
They ride on the hips.
They ride on the hips. They come across the chest and the shoulders. They try to displace that weight, okay?
And most guys still wear them wrong. They,
yeah,
wear them below their hips because it just doesn't feel right, right? Yeah. You got to get it up there, man.
And you can get this pad in many configurations with different types of buckles. This is pretty new. On the Vietnam era issue, they didn't have them, and or they were a different type of buckle. They were usually metal. All right, but all in all, I think I'm going to take this to the rendezvous, depending on how much gear I can get in or not in it. Okay, for stationary camping, I'm going to take it with me and see how it works. You don't have to go to the bank for this kind of stuff. You know, you can get. I'll tell you what, I'm putting together a kit. I have put together a kit that probably all in all is probably $100, and that's with the mess kit, and maybe the most expensive thing is the MSR pocket rocket or whatever. So that being said, real quick, and you can PM me, ask me any questions you want. Like I said, these are general videos. I want to show you a knife that you may have seen. This is the Grizz Primitive. This is made by Cody Roberts out of a Farrier File, okay? And it's an excellent chopper. It's a cross between a Nesmuk and a Kukri, all right? Just want to put that out there. Shout out to Cody.
All right, guys, before we go, I want to give a shout out to Jacob Peterson at the Prepper's Bunker, Beach and Tactical. Now, I get all my tactical slings from from Jacob because they're badass and they're bomb proof and they work, right? Because, you know, my motto is I like what works and works well, right? That's my thing. I don't want to take a piece of equipment out in the field that does not work well, right? So I do a lot of outdoor, you know, like field work to ascertain what is best for me, right? So just a shout out to Jacob Peterson at the Prepper's Bunker. You do very well, Jacob. Thank you. All right, guys. This is Doug and Bob. I'll see you on the next video.
Catch you later.
Bye-bye.
Take care. God bless.